The session consists of a short talk, takes about 15 minutes, mm-hmm. About Spitfire in general and this particular aircraft, and then we'll get you into the cockpit, okay. And I'll run through the controls and the startup procedure, then if you you'll have a chance to get some photos again at the end. Yeah. Okay. So I'm Chris, by the way. I'm the guide for this session. Have you been to Duxford before?
No, it's the first time. Yes.
First time, right, okay. Well, it's good that you're having this here because Duxford and the Spitfire have got an 84-year relationship, mm-hmm. so far, starting in 1938.
Yeah.
To understand how that came about, we just need to turn the clock back even further to the beginning of the 1930s. International tension was starting to rise again. Germany was beginning to rearm with the latest in aircraft technology, metal-bodied single-wing monoplanes, and the RAF took stock of the aircraft that we were flying at that stage, and they weren't very different in their construction and their speed from the ones that we'd been flying in the First World War.
Yeah.
So still wooden frames covered in fabric, open cockpits, mm-hmm. very little armament, not very different from the three aircraft that you see at the end of the hangar here from the late 1920s, early 1930s. So at the beginning of the 1930s, faced with that situation, a competition had been run for aircraft manufacturers to come up with a design of the next generation of fighter aircraft. And Supermarine had entered this particular aircraft, which they called the T-224, but they hadn't won the competition. It actually went to the Gloucester Aircraft Company for the Gloucester Gladiator, which ironically was still a biplane. It was the last operational biplane of the RAF. But spurred on by that setback, Supermarine gave free rein to their chief designer, Reginald Mitchell, to come up with a fighter aircraft that would actually go beyond what that specification was calling for. So that's what he went about doing, using expertise that he'd gained designing seaplanes for the Schneider Trophy races in the late 1920s. And if you look at that, the shape of that aircraft, you can see the kind of the design starting to evolve. So if you climb up onto the wing root, if you put your right foot onto the seat, don't worry about standing on the seat, keep facing towards the hangar doors, put your left foot onto the seat, and then just turn and slide down into the seat.
This way?
Turn to your left and slide down.
Okay?
Yeah. Yeah. So off you go.
Thank you.
Okay, so right foot onto the seat. Yeah, you can hold on any of the metal bits at the side.
This way?
Then put your other foot on there. That's it, and then turn and slide down. Great, well done. I've just got one more photo I need. Okay. So, what do you think?
Great. Let's start the engine.
So, as you can see, you've got virtually no forward visibility when it's on the ground, which is why at air shows and you see the pilots weaving down the runway and looking over the side so they can see where they're going. And it's quite a snug fit. They say that you climb into a Hurricane, but you put the Spitfire on.
Yeah, okay.
And I'll run through the controls. Although it's a live aircraft, you can move the foot pedals and you can move the control column.
It's a lot.
Yeah, you can move the control column from side to side. If you do that, you'll see the ailerons move. And if you move the foot pedals and look in the rear view mirror, you'll see the rudder moving.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
It's without motor. It's
it's very light, isn't it?
Very light. Yeah. Yes.
And I'm told that
unbelievable
in straight and level flight, it does handle as light as that. Obviously,
really?
it feels different when you're kind of manoeuvring, but
Yeah, it is.
This goes down, right?
Yeah, yeah. It resets itself. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very
so
light.
The dials and controls are pretty standard for an aircraft of this age. So, running along the top, you've got the airspeed indicator, artificial horizon,
mm-hmm.
climb indicator, mm-hmm. and engine speed. Top right.
This one?
That one, yeah. And then the next row is the altimeter, the direction indicator, which is sort of matches up with the compass down there, turn indicator, and then the red and the brown gauges there are the fuel and oil pressures, and to the right of those are the radiator and oil temperatures.
This one.
Temperatures, yeah. And then down at the bottom, you've got the fuel tanks themselves. And there are two fuel tanks on the Spitfire, one immediately above the other, and immediately in front of the cockpit, which is why fire was a problem on both the Spitfire and even more so on the Hurricane. And between the two tanks, there are 85 gallons of fuel, which on full throttle is about an hour's flying time. So they would throttle back whenever possible, you know, to conserve the flying time. So the startup procedure is you see the red switch there.
Mm-hmm.
That would be turned, and that opens one of the cocks on the top fuel tank, and then the brass button to the side of that.
Mm-hmm.
That's the primer, so that needs to be pressed about five times just to get some fuel into the carburetors.
Mm-hmm.
And then you see the two grey sliders there?
Yeah. Yes.
Immediately above those is the starter button. That one, yeah.
You have to push.
You push, yeah. Yeah.
And, this is all.
That's
it starts.
It's all sort of isolated. Yeah, the only things we can move are the joystick and the pedals. So normally from cold they would use an external battery on a trolley, because a 27 litre V12 engine takes quite a big kick to turn it over. But it could be started from the internal starter. Then once you've got the engine running, the main fuel cocks are the two grey sliders that I pointed out.
This one?
And they would be set the way they are there, which is taking fuel from the top tank initially, and then that would be closed, and the bottom one.
And these are both tanks?
Yeah, there's one for one for each tank. That's mm-hmm. right, yeah. So when you're ready for takeoff, you would have your right hand on the control stick, left hand on the throttle, and that would be pushed right to the end to get maximum thrust. So once you're airborne, you then move your left hand from the throttle onto the control column, because you need your right hand to get the undercarriage up. And this being an early mark.
This is this one.
That's the black lever there. Yeah.
And
that this being an early aircraft, it's got a manually operated undercarriage.
Really?
Yeah. So it needs about 15 pumps on there to get the wheels right up.
Up and down.
Up and down. Yeah. And the same in reverse as well. Yeah. So once it's flying along, the next things to adjust are the trim. So that's the trim on the rudder, and that's the trim on the elevators. And the idea of that is to get the aircraft almost to fly itself straight and level. And then what you also then need to do is make sure you're comfortable and that you've got reasonable forward visibility. So you can adjust the height of the seat,
mm-hmm.
and you do that in order to get as much of your body protected by this metal plate.
Yes.
Here. That's the only armor plating on a Spitfire.
The tanks are not armed.
No. Other than that, there's just one thickness of aluminium alloy, slightly less than a millimeter.
Really?
Yes. Yeah.
Not very good.
Not
protection.
Very good. Yeah. Not much protection for machine gun bullets, and certainly not from 20 millimeter cannon shells. So now once you're flying, there are three more bits of kit to point out. First is the HF radio and the setting for that, the adjuster for that is just there. So that's the tuner for the radio. They were still fitted with HF radios at that stage, which was quite a big piece of equipment in the back of the fuselage. But because this aircraft now has to comply with modern air traffic control, it also has a neat little VHF radio down in what originally would have been the map box.
Okay, this is the only new
that's
equipment.
The only giveaway to modernity. Yeah. Otherwise, all of the controls are exactly
as
they would have been in the Battle of Britain. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Final piece of equipment is the gun sight, which is immediately in front of you there, and that's called a reflector gun sight. So it has a light bulb in the bottom part, and that is projecting the actual gun sight up onto that glass screen. Uh-huh. So if you can imagine that
on this glass screen.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So it was a very early form of heads-up display. And there are two settings. There are two wheels on the site, one for range and one called base. And the range one is basically would have been harmonized with whatever the guns have been set for. So the 303 Browning machine guns only really pack a punch when they all converge to a single point. And that would normally be 300 meters in front of the aircraft. So the range would be set for that. But the other setting, the base one, what that does is it widens or narrows the gap on that horizontal line, depending on the size of the target. So obviously a Heinkel 111 is a much bigger aircraft than a Messerschmitt Bf 109, so that would be adjusted for that. So the idea is you get the target aircraft right in the center, mm-hmm. with those lines closed up on it. Okay. And then the real skill is anticipating what move the other aircraft is going to do, so that you can allow for deflection.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
to aim for where you think the aircraft is going to be rather than where it is. Yeah. And it was making that kind of instinctive adjustment that distinguished the fighter aces from the ones who were simply good pilots.
Yeah.
That type of gun sight was in use for most of the war. There was a gyroscopic one that was introduced later in the war, which did some of that adjustment and calculation, but the really experienced pilots still preferred these, you know, because they could do that faster than waiting for the gyro to tell them what to do.
Yeah.
And that basically is all of the controls. It's quite basic in some ways and quite advanced in others. The two rudder pedals are original from the original aircraft. So
really,
and they still say Super.
The writing on it is original.
Original. They still say Supermarine on there.
Yes.
And because it didn't see much service, they're not very worn. So Geoffrey Stevenson's feet were on those pedals when he landed on the beach at Songat in May 1940.
Yeah. Great.
Okay, so have you got any questions?
Very, very much instruments.
Yeah. I mean, this, when you think you're flying at, you know, you could be flying up to 360 miles an hour, and you're kind of monitoring.
You have to do all this.
All of that monitoring.
Manage this.
And manage that. Yeah.
And see how.
Yeah.
Which plane do we have?
Yeah.
And,
Yeah. And staying in formation with the other members of the squadron.
Yes. That's what is this?
That's the compass.
The compass.
Yeah.
So it goes.
That would that is gyroscopic, so that would move with the aircraft. Yeah. Oh, the other thing to point out is that's the firing button for the guns.
So, and
on a Mark 1 Spitfire, the pilots had roughly 15 seconds worth of ammunition.
15 seconds, then it's empty.
And then it's empty. Yeah. Because there were roughly 300 rounds of ammunition in each of the four gun compartments,
mm-hmm.
And a Browning fires at roughly 1,200 rounds per minute. So 300 into 1,200 gives you a quarter of a minute.
Okay. And four or two?
Eight.
Eight.
On a Mark 1s, there were four in each mm-hmm. in each wing.
And then when you push that,
and they all fire together. Because as I say, they really only pack their punch when they all converge to mm-hmm. a single point.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
But this and mirror is very, very.
They weren't standard when the aircraft were first designed. Mm-hmm. But the pilots.
The next one round.
It was much round, yeah,
and bigger.
They introduced concave ones as well to give a wider angle.
For here, you can go out with the with your head.
Yeah.
So when it's closed, that's also mechanical.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it's all mechanical. Yeah. So I won't clip this together, but as you can see, everything is
mechanical.
Yeah.
But it's really, really. A great restore.
Yeah, it is.
Great work.
Yeah.
So.
How are we doing for that? Oh yeah, we're okay for time. So do you want to, if you want to climb out and get some more photos?
There's
a series of programs of people who go on country walks and they carry these.
It
looks like a helicopter. yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah.
But man, I can't sit in such a Spitfire. I have to do every
what's the angle? Yeah, I'll step back.
Well, thank you. It looks like I'm a real pilot. This is really, really. Exact.
Yeah, it's very precise. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
This is special mechanic for the landing gears.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Yeah.
This part here.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Comes
yeah.
up.
Yeah. Yeah. Mind your head on the foot. Yeah.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting.
Good.
Thank you.
Good. Glad you enjoyed
great.
It. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you.
You're very welcome. You're very welcome.
Bye.
Yeah. You can just get round here. So.
Yeah.
Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.